Doing the right thing is never easy. Today, you might go for some greens, but you got to admit that a candy would be more tempting. In development, we tend to know what is the right thing to do. However, we also like to skip it sometimes whenever that right thing gives us extra hours of work. Today, I want us to talk about making the right decisions. Not only you'll make a better app tomorrow, but you'll also save yourself a lot of time in the long run. Last year, great people at CoolStack released their ultimate guide to reactnative optimization. It is 123 pages long, 123 pages to teach you the right thing to do. Now, if you don't have time to read those 123 pages, you're in the right place. This is probably the only series you need to watch to optimize your React Native experience. So sit back and enjoy a guide to React Native optimization. Before we start, I want to say that some of this advice might seem all straightforward to you, but trust me, there must be some that you don't know about yet. So feel free to navigate through them, but don't give up so easily on the chance to learn more. Alright, this guide is divided into three different types of optimization. Today, we'll focus on understanding React Native implementation details. Let's start with the first one. Pay attention to UI re-renders. This might be no surprise to you that React sometimes re-renders something that hasn't changed. It happens whenever a parent component updates and in turn re-renders all its children, or if a component props have changed, although it sometimes haven't. This can end up using a lot more memory or slowing down the device. Now, there are a few ways to reduce unnecessary updates. One, you can memoize your components and decide when they should re-render. Two, you can use uncontrolled components when possible. A text input value, for example, might flicker if you're typing too fast because React Native works asynchronously and could misalign JS native calls that can leave you with inconsistent values. If only the native side dictates the source of truth, you're simplifying the data flow here. Lastly, using a global state will also help so that each component only re-renders when what it is using from that state has been updated. You must know popular libraries that do just that, and it is highly recommended to prevent unnecessary updates. By using these techniques, you have fewer re-renders, meaning fewer resources needed and a faster application. 2. Use dedicated components for certain layouts. This one is fairly common. Don't use primitive components such as a scroll view and views for a big list when you can do it with an optimized higher component for that. Flat list is a big one since it makes huge lists much smoother by using a set of optimized techniques. Of course, these components can be configured and it's important to get familiar with all the options to get the best out of these. 3. Think twice before you pick an external library. You might often look at the number of stars, pull requests, and issues before using a project, but do you pay attention to its size, number of features and dependencies too? In fact, you need to remember that React Native has to load and parse all of the JavaScript code before booting your app. So making sure you're not using oversized libraries is essential to keep your app fast to load. For example, you'll likely need to manipulate dates, and moment.js is usually the way to go for this. The thing is, you might not need all of its features. And since the library is roughly 70 kilobytes, it might be worth looking into tinier packages that give you a subset of features like day.js, which is only 2 kilobytes. This small decision would reduce your date library by 35 times, and you could do the same for other utility projects such as Lodash. Always be very intentional and careful when adding external libraries. 4. Use libraries dedicated to the mobile platform. Most of the JavaScript ecosystem is web-based, and it's very common to use these libraries in our React Native projects. The difference is that oftentimes, these web-focused libraries might not be very well optimized for mobile, whereas CPU consumption is a critical metric when releasing your app on even low-end devices. iOS also will constantly optimize the battery life by analyzing an app's energy consumption. If you need to perform regular background tasks, it might change how often your app will get to run these tasks simply to reduce battery consumption. These are invisible consequences that you need to keep in mind while choosing libraries. The Firebase package is a great example of that. While you could use the web version, picking the React Native thin wrapper would be a better idea since it's optimized and built to run well on mobile. Always compare native and web-based libraries when available so you can pick the low CPU consumption one for your app. 5. Find the balance between native and JavaScript. You probably know how React Native works when it comes to communicating from native to JavaScript and vice versa. It's using a bridge to send a message from one box to the other, which adds extra time to standardize the communication, but also to get an answer from the native side. This both ways communication is essential right now, and while we're en route to get rid of the bridge with the React Native new architecture, these messages should be kept to a very low as much as possible. Here's a simple example of a library that will show a quick message on screen based on the native library. If for some reason we pass wrong parameters such as an empty message or duration, this means we're taking time to 1. Serialize and send a message to the bridge, 2. Wait for it to fail on native, 3. Native then generates an error, and 4. It serializes it and sends it back to JavaScript. But see, we could have avoided this communication by making sure on the JavaScript side of things that both of the parameters were correct. This is a very good example of how you can minimize these messages being sent to the bridge that could sometimes be handled on one side. Another common occurrence of this issue is when using objects for styles. You know that JavaScript and therefore React Native will consider these two objects as different, meaning if they're different, they will be sent twice to native, although it shouldn't have. In most cases, you can use the Stylesheet API to solve this issue so that it knows both styles are identical. The important thing to remember is that what seems harmless could be to some scale throughout your app what causes everything to be slow. Always remember how React Native deals with native communication and try to minimize all these unnecessary messages. 6. Animate at 60 frames per second no matter what. We are all used to smooth animations on daily apps and quick visual feedback. This is a key difference with the web, where being all animated isn't often necessary. If you've been following this channel, you'll know by now how difficult animation can be in React Native, especially when it comes to keeping them smooth. When possible, use the native driver that is provided with Animate, the React Native core animation library that runs animations real fast. If you deal with more sophisticated use cases, consider using React Native Reanimate and Gesture Handler that will both keep your interactions at 60 frames per second on most devices. Again, smooth animations are essential on mobile. Don't disregard them. Alright, before we end, here's a quick recap of the 6 first rules to optimize a React Native application. 1. Pay attention to UI re-renders. 2. Use dedicated components for certain layouts. 3. Think twice before you pick an external library. 4. Use libraries dedicated to the mobile platform. 5. Find the balance between native and JavaScript. And 6. Animate at 60 frames per second, no matter what. Okay, that's it for today. If you're a curious person, you can expect a lot more videos on this channel. Remember to subscribe if you don't want to miss it. Thanks for watching and see you next time.